I watched the Y-Files Electric Universe episode again recently and experienced the same mixed emotions. As much as I enjoyed it, and no publicity is bad publicity, or so they say, I was disappointed by the muddled approach and some of the basic errors. Please take note, I go into more detail in the Companion Thunder blog. As it happens, I'm a long-time subscriber to the Y-Files on YouTube. I enjoy their work, and Hechel Fish always makes me laugh. The Electric Universe episode first aired on October the 23rd, 2023, and followed the standard show format. EU concepts were explored enthusiastically to begin with, before AJ appointed himself judge, jury and executioner, and then proceeded to pass verdicts after examining some perceived weaknesses. As ever, the show finished on a positive note. The importance of keeping an open mind and the fact that we always have more to learn. They get it right more often than they get it wrong, in my humble opinion. Quote, I would rather have questions that can't be answered than answers that can't be questioned. Close quote. Richard Feynman. If I had to be critical of the Y-Files, I would say that the video titles tend to be sensational. I can understand this because we can all be tempted to bite on a little clickbait now and again, and the wording can also be important when gaming the algorithms on social media platforms. Unfortunately, the Electric Universe episode perpetuated several misconceptions. I'm not suggesting this was deliberate, and I can guess why it happened. For a start, there are a lot of mischief makers out there spreading disinformation, and there are several misunderstandings about EU ideas still doing the rounds, not least because many of its basic premises fly in the face of establishment science. There is another way of looking at it. It is important to understand that, while the Electric Universe can accommodate many ideas dismissed by orthodox science, it does not rest on them. Its basic tenets can be tested, and many of them have been verified, even if the implications remain to be fully recognised. Still, some of its more radical and challenging claims concerning cosmology and mythology are more difficult to test. Only time will tell. The biggest problem I had with this Y-Files was that it tried to cover too much in one episode. Different aspects of the EU model, like Birkeland currents, the ether, the electric sun, electric comets, planetary scars, petroglyphs, mythology and the nature of gravity, for example, would each require at least 20 minutes to cover the basics. Those who didn't already know a little about the EU are likely to have been overwhelmed, let alone confused. Entertained for sure, it's a great show, after all, but confused all the same. The Y-Files EU episode is entitled, quote, Gravity is a lie, light speed is slow, nothing is real, and the universe is electric, close quote. I'll take one at a time. Miss. Well, straight off the bat, the Electric Universe has never claimed that gravity is a lie. The primary issue is simple to summarise. While orthodox science works with only one tool in its box, gravity, the EU recognises that plasmas and electromagnetism play more important, if not dominant, roles on the grand scale. Hence the filamentary structure of the universe now observed via radio astronomy and, more recently and more clearly than ever, by the James Webb Space Telescope. Quote, students using astrophysical textbooks remain essentially ignorant of even the existence of plasma concepts, despite the fact that some of them have been known for half a century. Close quote. Hannes Alfvén, Nobel Prize winner, and the father of plasma physics and plasma cosmology. Hit. Well, given the vastness of the universe, light speed certainly is slow, snail's pace even. According to special relativity, the speed of light is a constant and the upper speed limit of the universe. The Electric Universe challenges both claims and more, and we are far from the only ones to do so. The EU view is that light is a wave in a medium, the ether of classical physics. Just to begin with, if light is a particle moving through a vacuum, as Einstein proposed, then how can it also display wave-like properties? It should be noted that Newton viewed gravity as an instantaneous force before Einstein conceptualized it as a property of curved space and limited to the speed of light. Miss. While the Electric Universe takes a more philosophical stance on science, which was originally known as natural philosophy after all, I'm not aware of any of its adherents claiming that nothing is real. Institutional science, on the other hand, displays something approaching an irrational fear of the philosophical issues. In simple terms, philosophy can be boiled down to three questions: what do we know, how do we know it, and how sure can we be? In respect of modern math-based cosmology, these three questions can be simplified into just one. Is mathematics really an infallible tool for establishing universal truths? Quote, philosophy is dead. Philosophers have not kept up with modern developments in science, particularly physics, close quote, Stephen Hawking. Typical of orthodox science today, did Hawking's attitude towards philosophical skepticism amount to a fear of scrutiny? Typical of his ilk, Hawking, after all, was a theoretical physicist, not an empirical scientist in the traditional sense. Hit. At 7 minutes 20, AJ elaborates, quote, if the electric universe is true, it will change everything we know about physics and reframe our understanding of the cosmos, close quote. Cosmology, the study of the nature of the universe, provides the building blocks for most other scientific disciplines. This adds to the inertia against change. Think grants, egos, and prestige. The electric universe represents a paradigm shift. It does not claim to have all the answers, but it is at least pointing in the right direction and can explain a lot more than the gravity-only paradigm. The Big Bang is the dominant cosmology right now, together with its partners in crime, general and special relativity. While questions abound about their veracity, the EU is not the only critic of establishment science. My recent blog, Einstein and the Cult of Celebrity, explores some of the doubts Einstein harboured about his own work before others ran with his ideas and ran and ran. Quote, since the mathematicians have invaded the theory of relativity, I do not understand it myself anymore, close quote, Albert Einstein. More EU topics that do not appear in the title are covered. Again, Wi-Fi's get more right than they get wrong, but small errors can distort the whole picture. I will therefore focus on a few of the shortcomings, albeit in no particular order. Hit. At 6 minutes and 7, AJ has this to say, quote, gravity isn't strong enough to keep everything together. Everything should fly apart, but it doesn't. So what is holding everything in place? Dark matter. But there is no proof that it exists. It's a band-aid. Close quote. Fine, but this also relates to the shortfall in mass required by gravitational theory. Gravity is a property of mass. Working on the assumption that their mathematical gravity-only theories must be correct, establishment science has balanced, fudged the equations, equivocations, some say, with hypothetical entities like dark matter. Furthermore, dark matter and dark energy now allegedly make up more than 90% of the universe. Quote, dark matter and dark energy are the blank checks required to postpone the falsification of bankrupt theories, close quote, the Thunderbolts project. At 32 minutes 50, AJ says, quote, the medium is the plasma that fills the entire universe. Physicists Kozarev and Tesla called this the ether and thought we could tap into this ether or plasma. This is zero-point energy, close quote. Well, not exactly. The ether of classical physics is something different from plasma. It can be thought of as a fine elastic medium or plenum that permeates everything. Think of it like this. While electrical currents travel in wires, electrical energy travels in the electrical fields outside the wire, on the hypothesized ether. The filamentary plasmas in space can be thought of as the electrical wiring of the universe. Our understanding of the ether as it stands is at a metaphysical level beyond this, although it is required by Maxwell's equations. Quote, in order to understand the phenomena in a certain plasma region, it is necessary to map not only the magnetic, but also the electric field and the electric currents. Space is filled with a network of currents that transfer energy and momentum over large or very large distances. The currents often pinch to filamentary or surface currents. The latter are likely to give space, as also interstellar and intergalactic space, a cellular structure. Close quote, Hannes Alfvén. Sure, the ether has a lot in common with much talked about zero-point energy, but the key point is that space, once thought to be a near-perfect vacuum, is now known to be alive with plasmas and electromagnetism, and we still have a lot more to learn about both. Miss. At 35 minutes and 10, AJ says he can find no record of Thornhill's successful predictions in respect of Deep Impact, the copper projectile that was crushed into Comet Temple 1 in 2005. These are, in fact, well documented, but it is not the first time they have been denied or downplayed. I'm guessing AJ has been misled by some of the so-called debunkers out there. Among other things, Thornhill stated that the impact crater would be much smaller than anticipated and that there would be a very bright pre-impact flash. He was right on both counts. NASA scientists were astonished by the events that unfolded and expressed their amazement on camera and in no uncertain terms. Quote, "I am at a loss to explain it," close quote, was just one typical exclamation at the time. Anyway, Matt Finn has beaten me to it. He has already set the record straight in this YouTube response from the Thunderbolts project. Miss. Warren Thornhill is the man behind the broad synthesis that is the contemporary electric universe. At 35 minutes 50, AJ says he can find no evidence of Thornhill's qualifications and that he worked as a salesman. Well, Wall has his own page on the prestigious IEEE Institute of Electrical and Electronic Engineers website. He received his Bachelor of Sciences in Physics and Electronics from Melbourne University, Australia in 1964 and spent most of his life working in software for IBM, not sales. Even before university, Wall had discovered the work of Emmanuel Velikovsky, whom he would later meet in person. Velikovsky inspired him to take a broad and interdisciplinary approach to the sciences, which became his lifelong passion. Much of Wall's work can be viewed on his website, holoscience.com. In July 2013, he was awarded the prestigious Sagnac Award for Lifetime Achievement at the 20th Annual Conference of the Natural Philosophy Alliance at the University of Maryland, College Park, USA. It's hard to imagine Wall saying something like, "I have no peers," as claimed, other than perhaps jokingly. More seriously, peer review is problematic, as we explained in the first episode of the Misconceptions series. According to Britannica.com, quote, "The primary function of peer review is gatekeeping," close quote. All the same, if peer review does it for you, Wall, together with CJ Ransom, has written a peer-reviewed paper on Supernova 1987A. At around the 8-minute mark, AJ discusses the Grand Canyon, one of the most iconic places in the world, and the possibility that a giant electrical spark, aka Thunderbolt, created it. An idea that sounds ridiculous to the uninitiated, of course. However, high-profile geologist Robert Schock has picked up on this theory recently. Before now, he has also acknowledged plasma phenomena in antiquity. Although the Grand Canyon is no doubt too much in the way of cognitive dissonance for many, the evidence for electrical planetary scarring on a less dramatic scale is ubiquitous. Take a look at our moon's surface, for example. The craters are nearly all flat-bottomed and roughly the same depth, regardless of size. Most of them are almost perfectly spherical. Some craters overlap without damaging the symmetry of those that went before them. And they all appear to have been impacted from 90 degrees above. How can the impact hypothesis explain this? You would expect impacting material to arrive from a variety of angles. Brian J. Ford, an amateur astronomer, argued the case for cosmic electrical discharge more than 50 years ago. The British Journal of Spaceflight published his work on the 7th of January 1965. In his laboratory experiments, Ford used spark machining apparatus to reproduce some of the most puzzling lunar features, including craters with central peaks, small craters perched on the high rims of larger craters, and crater chains. He also observed that the ratio of large to small craters on the moon matched the ratio seen in electrical arcing. Based on this EM premise, Velikovsky successfully predicted that moon rock would exhibit magnetic properties, yet another big surprise for establishment science. Planetary scars alone would surely make for an interesting Wi-Fi's episode. As mentioned, while plasma cosmology and the electric universe share more similarities than differences, they are at variance in some respects. The PC view, which is based on solid, verifiable science, although still largely ignored by orthodox science, acknowledges that many of our local stars' behaviours are essentially electromagnetic in nature. Quote, The forthcoming scientific revolution is presaged by the rapid pace of discoveries about our own star, the Sun, and its total plasma environments, close quote, plasmas.org. While Thornhill's EU view goes a step further, contending that stars are powered externally by Birkeland currents in space, the electric sun model was first proposed by the brilliant electrical engineer Ralph Jurgens in the 1970s. Quote, the modern astrophysical concept that ascribes the sun's energy to thermonuclear reactions deep in the solar interior is contradicted by nearly every observable aspect of the sun, close quote, Ralph Jurgens, 1980. Direct hit. At almost 39 minutes in, it is almost as if AJ has an epiphany when he says, quote, whenever I cover alternative science, I also give the view of the skeptics. But that is when, with this episode, I started to get upset. There are debunkers who think that Thornhill and other proponents of the electric universe should be silenced and that their research should be removed from the internet to protect us from disinformation. That's censorship and there's no place for it in science. Close quote. I can't argue with any of that. I think it's a fine summary. EU debunkers are also quick to resort to ad hominem attacks. In one YouTube video, for example, a certain detractor dismissed all interested parties as a gullible corner of the internet. Contrary to this unfounded generalization, quantcast.com provided the following analysis of Thunderbolts.info visitors not so long back. A comparison was made with badastronomy.com, run by Dr. Phil Plait, and Universe Today, the most popular mainstream astronomy websites and forums at the time. Thunderbolts also outranked Scientific American and Space.com. This is not to say non-academics are any less intelligent, but, well, you get the picture. Remember, there is even more to this story in the companion T-blog. Around the 43-minute mark, AJ launches a broadside against institutional science. Quote, science is now used to give more wealth to the wealthy. Science is used to give more power to the powerful. And science is now weaponized. Close quote. Well, well, strong stuff. He goes further. Quote, science isn't about truth, not anymore. Promote the right science and get a book deal and highly paid speaking engagements. But promote the wrong science and lose your reputation, lose your career, get deplatformed from social media, close quote. Again, strong stuff, but there's even more. Quote, when there's a mainstream view out there that suppresses debate and censors scientists that disagree, that mainstream view exists for money and power, not for the truth. And on that, there is no debate, close quote. Wow. What a perfect and powerful ending. Bravo, Y-Files. Thank you.